to hear and to study another portion of His holy and divine word. To those of you who are visiting with us and you're not members of Churches of Christ, we just want you to know that here at the Church of Christ, we love to have visitors, and we pray that it shows. Well, there were many places you could have been on a Tuesday evening, but you made the choice to come to the house of God, which is the church of the living God, the pillar and ground of the truth. I'm thankful to Brother Thompson, Brother Holloway, no relation, and the committee for allowing me to be able to speak on this lecture. I wasn't on the original speaking list, but I'm just so thankful that as people were being subbed in and subbed out, that Brother Thompson decided to look down the bench and saw that there was a preacher in Tucson and said, what the worst can happen? And decided to just let me get in the game.
That's all right.
So I'm just very appreciative of that. I believe the order got mixed up simply because Brother Carruthers should have been speaking last and I should have been speaking first. You know, in a relay, you don't put Usain Bolt first.
No.
Be the anchor, you put him last. But I'm so thankful for Brother Carruthers for giving me such a lead that I can slip, fall, drop the baton, take a nap, get back up, and we can still cross this finish line first on this evening. If you have your personal copy of God's Word, please turn with me, if you will, to the book of Romans. Romans, the chapter is 15, and the verse is 27. Romans, the chapter is 15, and the verse is 27. If you have it, let it be known by saying amen.
Amen.
Reading from the English Standard Version of the Bible, there you will find these words. For they were pleased to do it, and indeed they owe it to them. For if the Gentiles have come to share in their spiritual blessings, they ought also to be of service to them in material blessings. I've been given the subject of sharing spiritual and material blessings. Just going to do three things on this evening, and then the lesson is yours to respond to. First, we're going to give a definition to this title. Then we're going to give an explanation of this text, and then we will provide application for the Christian. First, let's deal with the definition of the title. When we look at this word sharing, sharing is defined as to use, participate in, enjoy, receive jointly. When we see this word spiritual in this text, spiritual is an adjective used to describe that which is invisible. And material is also an adjective used to describe that which is both physical and visible. But then we see this word blessing. And the word blessing is defined as a benefit bestowed. Therefore, when we look at Romans chapter 15, verse 27, we see that this verse speaks of the giving and the receiving of both immaterial as well as physical things for the improvement of those with whom we have fellowship. Now, this is an expression of love. When we obey this verse, this is an expression of love, and I believe Jesus got it right. When he said in John chapter 13, verse 34 and 35, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also are to love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one the other. Now, this definition of sharing spiritual as well as material blessings is consistent with the wisdom letter that we find in the New Testament. And that wisdom letter is the book of James. Just listen to two passages of scripture. Listen to your Bible in James chapter 2, verse 15 and 16. James chapter 2. Verse 15 and 16, the Bible reads, if a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, be warmed and filled, without giving them the things needed for the body, James asks the rhetorical question, what good is that? What we see in this text is that a spiritual need was met, which was encouragement, but a physical need was not met, which was food and clothing. Yeah. Now, this type of faith is as good to God as a Chinese nickel in a Japanese bazaar. It is no good to God, and it's no good to the church. But we also see in James chapter 5, verse 14, we saw a negative example in chapter 2. We now see a positive example of this principle in James chapter 5, verse 14. Listen to your Bible where the book says, is anyone among you sick? Well, then let him call for the elders of the church. And the elders are supposed to do two things. They are to pray over him. And then the second thing is anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Now we have to look at this text through first century eyes. Prayer is something that should never go out of style. But the oil that is being spoken of in the first century is that which was used for medicine or medicinal purposes. So the one called was commanded to provide both spiritual and material blessings for the one that was sick. Again, the title of tonight's message is not sharing spiritual or material blessings. The title is sharing spiritual and material blessings. Now let's deal with the explanation of the text of Romans chapter 15, verse 27. Now when we look at this letter to the Romans written by the Apostle Paul was close to ending his third missionary journey. Now this journey will end in Jerusalem as we follow his journey in the book of Acts. Now while in Greece, somewhere between Acts chapter 20 verse 3 and Acts chapter 20 verse 4, Paul decides to write two letters. He writes his second letter to the Corinthians, and then the second letter he writes is to the Romans, which is the book in question on tonight. Now, in this letter, he is informing the saints in Rome of his plans to visit them, but first, he has the need of going to Jerusalem because he is about to provide some relief to them that has been given to him to give to the brethren in Jerusalem from the brethren in Macedonia. Now, Paul had just left Macedonia in Acts chapter 20, verse 1 and 2. That was his second trip there. And he spends 3 months in Greece, and he went back through Macedonia, picked up some people to go with him to Jerusalem. But before he went to Jerusalem, he spent some time in Troas, and then he went to Ephesus, to Miletus, and began to encourage the Ephesian elders there. And then he sailed to a place called Tyre. And it was in Tyre that we see Paul's determination to get to Jerusalem. In Acts chapter 21, and the verse is 4, what we see in this text is that the Holy Spirit, through these brethren in Tyre, were trying to tell Paul not to go to Jerusalem. But Paul was determined to go to Jerusalem. I would like to think that if that was me, I would listen to the Holy Spirit. That I would try to heed that warning. If the money has been given to me, I'm not the only one in Tyre. I, I could have just given the money to Luke. And I said, well, the Holy Spirit didn't say you couldn't go to Jerusalem. I want to see my brethren in Rome, so I'm going to go ahead and give you the money, Luke, and I'm going head on to Rome. But Paul didn't heed the warning of the Holy Spirit in Tyre. So then he decided in Acts chapter 21, verses 8 through 14, to go to Caesarea. And he spends time at the house of Philip the evangelist. And it was in Caesarea that a prophet by the name of Agabus came along, and he took Paul's belt, and he bound his hands and feet, and he said, whoever this belt belongs to, this is how he's going to end up if he goes to Jerusalem. Now all the brethren in Caesarea are trying to convince Paul not to go to Jerusalem. Maybe if I didn't listen to God the first time in Tyre, maybe I would hear this second warning in Caesarea, especially when Agabus is the one who gave the word. And Agabus' history is that he bats 1,000 with his prophecies. Every time Agabus said something was going to happen, it happened. You don't doubt Agabus because he was truly a prophet of God. When he said a famine was going to hit Jerusalem in Acts chapter 11, what happened? A famine hit all of Judea. And when he told Paul that he would be arrested if he goes to Jerusalem, Paul should have took no. But he didn't. He decided to go to Jerusalem anyway. So he made it his mission. He went to Jerusalem. And guess what happened to Paul when he got to Jerusalem? He got arrested. Got dragged out the temple and was arrested. But it was at this time in Acts chapter 23, verse 11, that Jesus Christ speaks to Paul himself and said, you're not going to die here in Jerusalem, Paul. He said, you're not going to die in Jerusalem. He said, because just like you've been a witness of me in Jerusalem, I'm going to see to it that you testify of me also in Rome. And 3 years later, the Apostle Paul makes it to Rome. And so the brethren in Macedonia, according to Romans chapter 15, verse 27, wanted to provide benevolence to the poor saints in Jerusalem. Now, when we look at Romans chapter 15, verse 27, we see that the Apostle Paul mentions four things, and these are going to be our 4 points of application on tonight. The first thing that stands out in the text is that the Apostle Paul said that the Macedonian Christians were pleased to provide this benevolence to the poor disciples in Jerusalem. The second thing that Paul says is that the Macedonians owed this benevolence to the Christians in Jerusalem. That's an interesting word. He said they owed them this. The third thing that we see in this text is that the Macedonians benefited from the spiritual blessings they received from the brethren in Jerusalem. And we're going to show that connection on tonight. And finally, the Macedonians have a moral responsibility to minister to the saints in Jerusalem physically. So what are the 4 points of application on tonight? The first point of application is found in Acts chapter 20, verse 35. In Acts chapter 20, and the verse is 35, the Bible reads, in all things I have shown you that by working hard in this way, we must help the weak and remember the words of the Lord Jesus. How he himself said, it is more blessed to give than to receive. That's our first point of application on tonight. It is more blessed to give than to receive. The Macedonians were pleased to provide this benevolence to the poor saints in Jerusalem. As Christians, we must understand that it is not a sin to give. Let me say that again. Sometimes we forget that on Sunday. It is not a sin to give. But also the Bible makes it equally clear that it is not a sin to receive. When we give, we will be blessed. When we receive, we are being blessed. However, we are more blessed through our giving than we are in our receiving. And so the Christian ought to be motivated in the work of sharing spiritual as well as material blessings, understanding the inevitable blessings they will receive both in this life and or in the next. Therefore, we must choose to be conduits and not cul-de-sacs. Yeah. We must choose to be rivers, yes, and not reservoirs. Yeah. We must choose to be channels and not receptacles. Yeah. We must be people that are not only blessed, not stressed, and highly favored, but as saints, we must also be a blessing and not a burden to others. Yeah. And why is that? Yeah. Because it is more blessed to give than to receive. And the Macedonians understood this. The second point of application is found in Galatians chapter 6, verse 6. In Galatians, the chapter is 6, and the verse is 6. The Bible says, let the one who is taught the word share all good things with the one who teaches. Yeah. Think back to the time when we were lost. When we were dead in our trespasses and sins. When we lived in disobedience. When we carried out the passions of the flesh. Remember when we were separated from God without mercy and no hope in the world? Think about where we would be if we died that way. If we died in that state. How thankful are you on tonight to that individual who shared the glorious gospel of Jesus Christ with you, which served as the means to bring you out of darkness and into the marvelous light of God? Are you thankful enough to pray for that individual? Are you thankful enough to assist that individual? Are you thankful enough to support that individual in the work that they are doing so that other people can be delivered from the snares of Satan, just like you were snatched from the snares of Satan? Thank God for people who take seriously the responsibility to evangelize the lost. We need to thank God for the person in our lives who lived in our community, who didn't walk past us, but taught us. That's right. We need to thank God for the person at our school or at our job that didn't ignore us, but taught us. Right. We need to thank our friends and our family member, whoever that individual may be, who decided to put fellowship before friendship, who decided to put my salvation before blood. And to those who have heard the gospel in a foreign land, we need to thank God for that individual who sacrificed time, who sacrificed their treasure, and in many instances have sacrificed their own tranquility to take seriously the great commission of our Lord. Amen. Now, the gospel may be free, but ministry is costly. You know, there would be no Peter if there hadn't been an Andrew. Aren't you thankful for Andrew? You know, there would be no Paul if there hadn't been an Ananias. Thank God for Ananias. There would be no us if it had not been for the person who taught us. So the question we need to ask on this evening is this: are we expressing our gratitude through the sharing of spiritual and material blessings? So again, the second application is that we must have an attitude of gratitude. As we go to application number 3, that's found in Ephesians chapter 1, beginning with verse 3. In Ephesians chapter 1, beginning with verse 3, the Bible reads, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him. In love he predestined us for adoption as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace with which he has blessed us in the beloved. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth. In him we have obtained an inheritance, having been predestined according to the purpose of him who works all things according to the counsel of his will, so that we who were the first to hope in Christ might be to the praise of his glory. In him you also, when you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and believed in him, were sealed with the promised Holy Spirit, who is the guarantee of our inheritance until we acquire possession of it to the praise of his glory." The third application on tonight is that we must view our spiritual blessings as true blessings. You know, if we can't feel it, if we can't touch it, if we can't see it, oftentimes it doesn't count. That's how many Christians think. But I read somewhere where the Apostle Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7, that we're supposed to walk by faith and not by sight. So when we look at Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14, these verses speak of at least 5 spiritual blessings we receive upon hearing the word of God, believing it, and obeying it. Unfortunately, many Christians are so caught up with the cares and thoughts of this world, we forget how blessed we really are being in Christ Jesus. We focus so much on the material and physical things we lost and didn't get, that we might lose sight altogether of all that God has already done for us, is doing for us, and will continue to do for us. See, according to Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 14, we receive grace. That's a spiritual blessing. We receive the redemption through his blood. That's a spiritual blessing. We receive the forgiveness of our sins. That's a spiritual blessing. We receive an inheritance. That's a spiritual blessing. We also receive the seal of the promised Holy Spirit. Now, we can either be like Esau and give up our birthright for something that is temporary, or we can be like Jacob and value the birthright above everything else. See, the Macedonians received these spiritual blessings and more because of the work of Paul and the work of Silas. And it was in Paul's second journey that he taught the Macedonians the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, where does Jerusalem come in at? Well, we see that the Apostle Paul used to be a member of the local church in Jerusalem in Acts chapter 9, before he was threatened and went to Caesarea and then on down to Tarsus. We also see that Silas was a leading brother and prophet in the church in Jerusalem. And he was the one that accompanied Paul in Acts chapter 16, Acts chapter 17, and Acts chapter 18 in teaching the Macedonians. We see that it was in Macedonia that Lydia and her household obeyed the gospel and received these spiritual blessings. We see that the Philippian jailer and his household heard the gospel and received these spiritual blessings. We see that the Corinthians heard the gospel, obeyed that gospel, and received these spiritual blessings. We see that the Thessalonians, the Bereans, and the Athenians also heard this glorious gospel, this implanted word, which is able to save their soul. The Macedonians did not take for granted how their lives were changed for the better because of the spiritual blessings they received, and neither should we. This is why I went upon life billows. We are tempted talks. When you are discouraged, thinking all is lost, all we have to do is count our blessings and name them one by one. And it will surprise you what the Lord has done. Let me hasten to my conclusion on tonight by going to 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 12. 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 12. The Bible reads in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 12, "For the ministry of this service is not only supplying the needs of the saints, but is also overflowing with many thanksgivings to God." Our fourth and final application is this: we must serve God and others. This is our primary ministry. Don't you know that service is the rent we pay for the room we occupy here on earth? This is something that we ought to be doing. The service pleasing and acceptable to God is when we voluntarily submit ourselves to do what is right according to God and what is needful for the soul, our brethren, and the world, both willingly and enthusiastically. But don't you know that we serve God through worship? So let us worship truthfully and faithfully. Don't you know that we serve our souls through study? The study of the scriptures. So let us study the scriptures openly and diligently. We serve our brethren through fellowship. So let us nurture this relationship daily. And we serve the world through evangelism. So let us share the gospel urgently. Don't you know when the Bible talks about spiritual and physical blessings, we must do both. We must pray, but let us also provide. We must reprove, but let us also relieve. We must build up, but let us also build. We must counsel, but let us also clothe. We must be on fire for the Lord, but let us also feed the hungry of the Lord. We have been blessed both spiritually and materially, and now it's time for us to not only be blessed, but to be a blessing to others, both spiritually and materially. I thank you so much for your time and attention on this evening. God loves you, I do too. Let us have a great remainder of the evening in the Lord. Amen.